Hi, this is Terri Thompson, and this is It's About Writing. Today we have Pegg Thomas, and I'm so excited to have you here. Finally, we've tried to make this meeting happen a couple of times and didn't work out. So today we finally have it going. Pegg is a historical romance writer, and she has 5 published books, and she's also taught writers, but I'll let her tell more about herself and her books. Hi, Pegg.
Hi, Terri. Thanks for letting me come on today and talk to your viewers and tell them a little bit about what I do as a historical and historical fiction writer. And I, as you mentioned, have taught at a number of writers' conferences in the last few years, and I really enjoy teaching and working with people. I was also the managing editor for Smitten Historical Romance for the last 3.5 years. I just stepped down in October and left it in good hands with someone else to focus more on my own writing. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I really enjoy is using real history in my books. And when I was editing, I would look for books that used real history in them. But I found that people tended to have sort of a misconception about what historical or historical romance was as far as the history went. And so I did come up with a presentation to help people with that. And to me, history, when it's woven into the story, very organically into the story, just adds a layer of richness mm-hmm. that you can't get necessarily in a modern or contemporary story. But there are so many red flags that can pop up at you if you're not careful. And I kind of want to talk about that today, about the research and the red flags and striking that balance. So the first thing I would say to people that's the most important, if you don't remember anything else about this talk, is that your point of view character, who I'll just call POV from now on, Ooh. Your POV character's perspective always, always, always trumps the historical data. When we tell a story, especially if you're in the romance genre, you're going to tell it from that third person point of view, and you want the third person point of view to be as deep as it can be, because you want to suck your reader right into that story where they're living it with your characters, where they're seeing what your character's seeing, they're smelling what your character's smelling, they're right there beside them. And so you want your historical details to just flavor your story. Think of the difference of standing over a pan of warm cinnamon rolls right out of the oven or driving past a newly flattened skunk on the road. You know, you want that beautiful, wonderful aroma. You don't want it to stink the thing up. So that's about the best way I can say it. So there are do's you want to definitely take care of when you're writing historical. You do want to research the era that your story is set in. I spent most of my life researching the eras that I love, which is colonial America up through just post-Civil War. I started reading biographies when I was in elementary school. I've always been fascinated with that time. It's a good 100 year span, but I just have loved it, spent a lot of time in it. But even so, before I write a book, when I know where I've got it set, I start doing a lot of really deep research to find out what was going on there, to learn about everything I can about it. One thing I want to warn people about, because I really found this to be, as a managing editor, a problem, is people would go research and they would go to Wikipedia. Wikipedia is a great place to get something fast. It is not a great place to get something right. Okay, it's not a reliable source. Always go to something like history.com, or if you're studying Civil War, which was a known Civil War site, go to someplace where you've got a better credibility. Wikipedia can lead you very, very wrong. One of the best things you can do when you find a period, then you know your period, is find a book written in that period, because it will tell you a lot about the society of that time. It can be a fiction book, but if it's written in that time period and it's contemporary for that time period, you'll learn a lot about the time. So that's a good way to get it. Journals are wonderful if you can find firsthand accounts. Those are my treasure troves. I absolutely love to find journals. And sometimes it's hard when I'm writing about something in the 1600s, but there are some journals out there, and they just add so much to the story. They help you as an author understand your time period. You may never put anything in your story that's in those journals, but because you understand your time period better, it will be more authentic when it comes through.
Where would you find something like that?
I have a very good friend who's a librarian.
Talk to a librarian.
Make good friends with librarians. Mm-hmm. They can find you these things. Okay. And that's my best clue there. You could spend days searching on the internet and not find it. If you know a good librarian and you'd ask them, they'll find it for you, which is great.
Great tip.
Maps of the day are awesome. If you can find maps of the day, and there's an amazing amount of them out there. There's some government sites that have maps. I don't have any of them written down, but if you Google government sites and maps, you'll come up with some pretty good ones. And another one is watch a reliable movie source set in that time period. Something like a masterpiece theater presentation, you know, one of these that takes the time and really researches the costumes and the mannerisms and things that you can kind of absorb by watching it. That's helpful. Mm-hmm. You want to write dialogue that's going to reflect, another do here, that reflects the speech patterns of the day. So if you were writing something from the 1920s, you're going to want something like, it's the cat's pajamas. You know, you're going to want some sort of a little speech that's going to, as soon as people hear it, they're going to go, oh, flapper, you know, it brings it up. And every time period has something like that. And you want to pick one or two words that reflect the era and also the place. You know, if you're writing Kentucky Daniel Boone era, they're going to call a gun a blunderbuss, right? If you're talking maybe like West Virginia area, and they're very superstitious back in the day, and they would talk about haints. Haints were ghosts, you know. So, but people who pick that up, and you only have to use a word or two like that, and it flavors the whole story. Or if you have immigrants, pick a couple of foreign words that you will use, just easy ones like French, and you've got oui, right, for yes, or if it's Russian, yet, for no. I mean, you don't need big words, you just a little bit to give that feel. And remember, every era has its own contractions, and every area has its own contractions. So if you're in colonial, you're saying tis and twasn't. If you're in Appalachian hillbillies, then you've got ain't and can't. And so you use those to flavor your speech as well, because it sets the reader right down in the story. Mm-hmm. But you can overdo it.
Right.
So do use these things, but use a couple. Don't use one in every paragraph. Don't be careful of how often you do it. Flavor it. Like I said, remember the cinnamon rolls as opposed to the dead skunk. So you want to be careful on that. Another do is to know the historical highlights in the era that you're writing. So if you think about it, probably most people, if they love historical, watch Downton Abbey at some point. Downton Abbey was brilliant writing. If you haven't seen it and you're writing historical, you really ought to watch it, because the writing was absolutely brilliant. They start the entire series with the news that the Titanic sank. They never had to tell anybody what year it was, because history gurus all knew it was 1912, the Titanic sank. And so by starting with that one historical event, they set the entire series. So that's brilliant writing. Mm-hmm. If you can do something like that, you might win an award. But there's other things, like 1930s, we had the Hindenburg. 1863 is when the Civil War started. And what else can I think of? I've drawn it. Oh, first man walked on the moon, right? 1969. So things like that you can toss into the story, and you can only do it if it affects your point of view characters. Okay, it has to be from the point of view of your characters, but it will set your reader right down into the story. And also know the historical figures of your day. If you're writing about the Civil War, think of the big historical figures. Lincoln jumps right to mind. Frederick Douglass jumps to mind. There's characters you could pull out of there that maybe the point of view character is reading the newspaper and it's got something about Lincoln in it. You don't need to go any farther than that.
Right.
He's reading that and sees the story about Lincoln, and then you have his reaction to it. His reaction is going to tell the reader if he favors the Union or if he favors the Confederacy, right? Mm-hmm. So we just got a little insight into the character by using a name in a newspaper. And it set, again, sets the reader right down in that story. Some other ones that I was thinking of as I was going through was, you know, maybe your point of view character is that during the Revolutionary War, and he is scandalized by something Benedict Arnold did. Or maybe he wishes he would have done what Benedict Arnold did. How your point of view character reacts to those real history situations is going to tell your reader a ton about the character himself, the point of view character. So don't be afraid to use those to deepen your story.
Kind of simplifies it too.
And actually you have to write a lot less if you use things like that, where you might had to have spent a paragraph or two explaining this character's geopolitical background or thoughts and ideology. You can use something like this with a quick reaction, a sentence or two, the reader understands. Sometimes it's a way to really move the story forward in a meaningful and fun way. Fun to write. I think it's fun to write anyway. And the last do I have is know how your characters would dress and their social manners of the day. Remember, if you're writing historical, much more so than today, there was social strata, okay? Even in this country, you know, if you're writing, obviously in England, it was a much more distance than it was here. But even here, you had upper class, you had lower class. The middle class didn't come around until fairly recently, as far as history goes. You had upper and lower. That was about it. But even within those, there was structures. There was layers of upper class and layers of lower class, okay? So know where your character is and understand how they would have dressed and how they, what their mannerisms would have been. Obviously, the upper class had very different manners than the lower class, but especially if you're going back like colonial era, the manners of the lower class were just as important to them as the manners of the upper class were to them. We don't have a lot of manners anymore in our society. But one of the things that will make your writing shine and stand out to people who love history is making sure that your historical characters have the authentic manners that they had back then, because it shows through. Because calling everybody by their first name never happened in history. Did not. There were women who never referred to their husbands as other than Mr. So-and-so.
Yes.
Even though they were married, which is just bizarre to us.
Right.
And you might not want to take it that far as your fiction goes. But when a man was courting a woman, never called her by her first name. It was always Miss So-and-so. So things like that, just it's a subtle thing, but as the history person reading it, and you assume if they're reading your book and you write historical, then they love history, because why else they read your book? They get that. And so it makes a difference. It adds to the whole flavor. Let me go through the don'ts too. That was the do, things you want to do. Don't write a documentary. Okay? People are picking up your book. It's fiction. They want a good story. It's entertainment. Now, I actually read documentaries for entertainment, but I'm kind of strange that way. And I don't want to get a documentary if I bought a fiction book.
Right.
Okay. Don't use excessive dialect in your dialogue. There was a day when it was wonderful to do. If you've ever read any of James Herriot's books, he was the Yorkshire veterinarian. He wrote heavy, heavy dialect, and I absolutely loved it. Still love it to this day. No publisher would have signed him today.
Right.
Just don't, because we have sadly dumbed our culture down to where we can't read it and understand it anymore.
Right.
That's not a good commentary on us. And we lose that real deep involvement with another culture, which is a sad, but it's just the way it is. And we can't change it. So don't use excessive dialogue. Use a word or two here and there, but not, don't hit your reader over the head with it. Also, don't knock your reader over the head with facts and figures. They're not reading a ledger. They're reading a fiction book. Mm-hmm. So they want to be entertained. And don't make your fictional characters best friends with historical figures. Reasons are, if you get anything wrong, some history buff is going to call you out on it in a review. Just bank on it. Mm-hmm. The other reason is, even though historical figures are fair game, and I use them in my stories as secondary characters or as what I call drive-through characters, where they make cameos and move off screen, but they have descendants. Mm-hmm. And if you write them in a way that, even though it's fiction, and they are fair game if they were political characters, they are, but you could still get into a little bit of trouble if you twist the history too much.
Yeah,
it's not worth it to get into a controversy with somebody's descendants. It's just not. So use historical figures, let them flavor your story, have them do a walk-off, you know, walk-on, walk-off screen cameo or drive-by or whatever you want to call it. But don't make them too central of a character. Mm-hmm. You're just kind of asking for trouble.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And the other don't is don't describe clothing, buildings, or battles to excess. Mm. Nothing is more boring than listening to reading, and I've done this. You're reading a story, and the woman is getting dressed, garment by garment, like, and they wore a lot of clothes back then. And you're listening to everything she's putting on, and you're tired before the woman's dressed. So you don't want to do that. Talk about some of the clothing, give a flavor for what it's like, but don't stitch everything together. Let the reader figure some of it out themselves. And when you do put it in there, you want to put it in there as organically and seamlessly as possible. You don't want to describe a woman getting dressed, mm-hmm. because that's kind of like watching dry paint fade. Mm-hmm. So instead, what you want to do is maybe she's looking in her armoire, because they didn't have closets back then. She's looking in her armoire. She's trying to decide what to wear, and she's trying to pick out something that will make her look her best. Okay, now there's an organic way to her, as the point of view character, looking at her clothing is a way to do it that's organic. You say she's going to a dance, and she wants to show up so-and-so, who's her rival, and so-and-so always wears red, so she's going to pick something that's so different, and then you're in her head. Mm-hmm. And when you're in her head and you're becoming that character, so is your reader. Your reader's now in her head. And your reader's thinking, pick the brown, or whatever. You know, you get them involved in it. But remember that any of these kind of descriptions have to be in that point of view character's mm-hmm. point of view. That's the whole purpose of having one. The only time you might flip it, especially if you're writing a romance where you're going back and forth between his and her points of view, what he sees her in, now you're describing it from his point of view. Remember to think like a man, though, okay? Don't think like a woman when you're in his point of view. Always think like a man. And when you're in her point of view looking at him, you want to be thinking like a woman.
Yeah.
Okay? So that you can picture it, you know? Guy's looking at a pretty woman, he's not thinking the same thing another woman would be thinking.
Right.
You don't want to get crude about it, but you want to keep that straight. You want that to be, again, organic to the character and to the story.
Wow, such good advice.
Let me run through some red flags that I find often when I'm editing for things. First red flag is to check for the things. If there's a thing in your story, you need to know that the thing had been invented in that time.
Yes. Good idea. That's
very, very important. This is one of the reasons I love writing colonial America, because like they had horses and fire and that was about it. It's really easy. You don't have to worry about too much stuff. The farther you get into history, the more things had been invented and you need to look it up. For instance, this is one of my favorite examples. You might mention a bicycle set in a story in 1800, or maybe a steam engine in a story in 1770. Which one of those is actually correct?
Ooh.
It's the steam engine. Oh. The steam engine was around in 1770. The bicycle was not invented until 1817.
Wow.
And I only knew that because I looked it up. Because when I write something, I have to go look it up. And for this particular story I was writing, I wanted the girl on a bike, and I went and looked, and it's like, there weren't bikes.
Wow.
Didn't exist yet. Another thing to check for red flag are the critters, as I call them. I had an author that sent me a book for Smitten, and I'm going through it, and all of a sudden there's this golden retriever. And I thought, I wonder when golden retrievers made it to America, because I knew it was actually a breed from Scotland. So I had to go look it up. And they came from Scotland, but not until the mid, or they were developed in Scotland in the mid-1800s, didn't come to America until the 1890s.
Wow, that
the
is something
I really... The story was set during the Civil War, so we couldn't use it.
Wow.
She had to come up with a different breed of dog. Another story mentioned Black Angus cattle in Texas during the Mexican-American War, so I had to go look it up. Mexican-American War was 1846, 1848. First Angus cattle came to the U.S. 1873.
Wow.
Almost 30, yeah, over 30 years later. So you have to know when things happened and where they would have logically been. You know, and the first cattle that came to Texas, or came to America, the first black, they didn't go to Texas. So they weren't even there for years after that. That's just when they first got to the U.S. So you need to know those. Probably the most important is to get your horse facts straight, because there are a lot of horse people still out there. A lot, like me, okay? I'm a horse person too. There is nothing that will throw you out of the story faster than having it have incorrect horse facts. Mm-hmm. The horses, you know, they're messing up a halter versus a bridle, a saddle versus a harness. They don't understand. If you're going to write historical, you need to know horses, because America, especially if you're writing like what I do, colonial through Civil War, America was built on the back of a horse.
Mm-hmm.
A horse was part of everyday life. Unless you were a city dweller who never left town, you had a horse, and you had to know how to handle it, and you had to know how everything that went with it. So if you're writing historical and you're going to ride horses, you need to get on a horse. If you've never been on one, go to a riding stable and get on one. If you've never been in a cart pulled by one, find a cart somewhere. Go on Craigslist. I need to rent somebody with cart to take me for a ride. And I need to be there to watch it harnessed and to watch it unharnessed. I need to see how this happens. People will be thrilled to help you do that.
Yeah,
people who are readers will swarm to you and say, come on over. If you get it right, I'll show you whatever you want. Okay. You need to know the different gaits of a horse. What are they called? Walk, trot, canter, lope. What does it all mean? So if you get that right, you will win the hearts and minds of many of your historical readers. For example, I had an author with Smitten who loved this scene she wrote where it was a Scottish Highlander, and he was on a big black horse, and he put the girl on the back of the horse, and then he got in the saddle in front of her.
Oh,
and I said, that's not physically possible. aside from the fact that he's wearing a kilt, which would really make it, she didn't know how you got on a horse. You have to throw your leg over the other side behind the saddle.
Yeah.
But you can't do if the girl's sitting there. You're going to knock her off. And we went back and forth over this. So you need to get that. You need to get horses down pat if you're really going to write authentic history. They were too important to history to not know those things.
Plus it would be fun to research.
Yeah, exactly. Especially if you got to go out and, you know, get find somebody you could hire out to take you out on a wagon with a team. Can you imagine? Just have fun afternoon.
Yeah.
My last red flag is double check all dates. If you have a date in your story, double check that it's right. Even if you think it's right, even if you know it's right, double check it anyway, because you might even find you just typed the wrong number in. And getting dates wrong is deadly. You know, if you're writing about the Battle of Gettysburg and you goof on the date, there are approximately 35 million Gettysburg reenactors who will come after you and tell you, you obviously shouldn't be writing this book. You don't know what you're talking about. Even if it's a typo, they will say that. So you want to get that right. Striking the balance is the next part that's important. And it comes down to your point of view characters. As I've said, even in the very beginning, what your point of view character can see, hear, know, and would logically respond to trumps real history. And I had another Smitten book come through that was another Civil War story. And she knew the history. She knew the battles. She knew everything. And she put all those details in the story. But the hero of the story was a Confederate foot soldier. And a Confederate foot soldier could not have known the details that she had in the story. Oh. He would have had no way. Remember, they didn't have CNN back then. There was no Twitter. Mm-hmm. If you were a grunt soldier, you knew what your commanders told you, and they weren't going to tell you very much. Mm-hmm. You certainly didn't know the names of all the commanders of the other side. You just wouldn't. You would have no access to newspapers on any kind of a regular basis. Mm-hmm. And even if you did, by the time you would get one, wherever that general was, he wasn't there anymore. And so you had no idea who was up in front of you. Your commanding officers probably did. They had scouts out. They were getting reports, but the foot soldiers were not. So you have to make sure the only history you put in is the history that your point of view characters can logically know, or that they would logically react to. There might be some stuff they could know, but it's just it's a point of history they wouldn't care about. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're in a point of view character of this foot soldier and there's a new woman's fashion out that year, he ain't gonna know that. He's not gonna care. And even if he heard about it, he's not gonna remember. He's a guy, he's not gonna remember it. So you have to make it believable in that way. The only time you can get away with some of those is to write omniscient point of view. But in today's publishing culture, omniscient point of view is pretty much a dinosaur.
Right.
There are a few books that have come out recently in omniscient, which kind of surprised me. I don't know how well they're selling, but certainly if you're in romance, you don't want to do omniscient. That doesn't work for romance. So make sure that the history is the foil behind the story, because it's historical fiction. Historical modifies fiction. It is at center fiction. At center, it's a story that the history is helping to flesh out and to make deeper and richer and better for the reader. Mm-hmm. But you never want the history to trump the story. You want the story always to be the focus, and you want it to be flavored by all this wonderful history that you're going to be going through. And the last thing I would talk about is using historical events intentionally. And there's a way to do that that helps you to move your story forward. I don't know how much story structure some people have. Some people are pantsers. Pantsers, however, wind up with story structure. They just get there a different way. Mm-hmm. They may have to write 15 drafts to get there, but they get there. Mm-hmm. But the very, very basics of story structure is something really important needs to happen at the 20 to 25% mark. We call that the first plot point. Something has to happen at the 50% mark, and we call that the midpoint shift, usually. And something has to happen at 75% mark, and that is that second plot point. Those are the things that keep your story moving forward and not sagging in the middle. You got that saggy middle? You need to find your plot points. If you're writing historical or historical romance, you can use real history. Now, you wouldn't want to use real history for all three, because that's going to be forced, okay? It's going to look forced. It's going to look like, well, she just shoved in all the history she could find. But you can use it for one, maybe even two of those points. And here's kind of an idea that I came up with a couple of examples. Again, always keeping in mind, it has to come through your point of view character's thoughts. It has to be around what your point of view character is thinking, how this event is affecting them. Mm-hmm. So let's say your story is a historical romance set in New Jersey in 1937. The young lovers are locked in a tug-of-war battle of romantic angst, just like they always are in every historical romance ever. You're at the 75% mark of the book, and he takes her to see the much-touted arrival of the Hindenburg. Mm. We all know what happens, right? The Hindenburg bursts into flames in front of the crowd. Okay, what if he sees this and realizes that life is short and decides he's going to marry that girl no matter what? But she sees the burning airship and decides that it's a symbol of their disastrous relationship. Now you have 25% of the book left to tell the reader how, not tell, that's a bad word, show the reader how you get your characters from this completely different reactions to the same historical event and bring them together for the happily ever after you have to have in a romance. So that's using history in a way to really bring the story to life. And it would be a great 75% mark. And if anybody wants to take that idea and run with it, feel free. I don't write anything past the 1880s at the very latest. So feel free to grab that idea and go.
Yeah.
And that's what I've got on blending history with plot and fiction. Like I said, if you take nothing else away, remember that the story trumps the history, and that it always has to be history from the eyes of the point of view characters.
Mm-hmm. Wow, Pegg, thanks so much. That's really helpful. Especially if anyone is doing NaNoWriMo and working on a historical, you can use these things. And
absolutely. And I use them myself. In fact, my last book that I put out, The Blacksmith Brides, is a collection of four novellas. And my novella was set during just before the Revolutionary War started. And I used Daniel Boone in the book. And even Benjamin Franklin makes a cameo appearance.
Oh. He just
basically waves from a coach as he goes by, but it was a neat moment. And so I got to use some of what I just taught about, and I got to use real historical events and then how they affected my characters and how my characters thought about them and how their lives actually were changed by some of the things going on at the time. So,
well, I love to read historical romance, so I'm going to have to look that up and see it. That would be
I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
It's gotten very good reviews, so I'm really happy with it.
Great. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Can you just show us your spinning wheel behind you?
Oh, yes. This is my Revolutionary War era. It's called the Great Wheel or a Walking Wheel. I rescued that a few years ago and was able to refinish it. I can spin on it. It works. It's completely functional. I did have this piece right here, which is called the Quill. I did have this one manufactured to go with it. I have the original, but it's so old and so frail that I don't use it. I keep it in a drawer to keep it, but that's the original one. And the metal's kind of pockmarked, and it's just worn from years of use, and I didn't want it to get damaged, so I contracted somebody to make me a replacement part. And then downstairs, I have two new antique wheels that I bought in the past year. One is a Saxony wheel, which would have been used for spinning flax for the most part. It's a flax wheel. And then I wound up sort of accidentally buying another one. My husband's still wondering about that, which is my newest one. It was probably 1920s to 1930s, and it was made by the Hutterites, who are another Anabaptist group like the Mennonites and the Amish. And it has their mark on it, so I know it comes from them. My flax wheel is probably 1830s to 1840s, and I do spin on that frequently. I did have to have a couple more replacement parts for it, but I spin on that one pretty regularly too. So, and then I have a modern production wheel that I use. And if you subscribe to my newsletter, which you can find the subscription at peggthomas.com, Pegg with two G's, by the way, PeggThomas.com, I have a subscription to my newsletter, and when I release a book, I give away one of my signature shawls. I actually have my own sheep. I raise my own wool, and I'll spin it, and I knit shawls that I give away with the release of each book.
Oh.
But it only goes to a newsletter subscriber, so the only way you can get in the drawing is to join my newsletter.
Well, I've already joined that.
Good.
I'm on there, so that's good. Wow, that's so interesting and fun. Well, thank you so much for sharing all this information with us and just sharing a little bit of who you are. It's been fun to hear you, and I'm glad we finally got to it.
I am too. It has been fun to get here and chance to meet your watchers and other authors. And hopefully I was able to shed some light on a little bit of how to work with history and fiction today.
Yes. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.